If anyone does not abide in me, he is cast out as a branch and is withered, and they gather them and throw them into the fire, and they are burned. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, you will ask what you desire, and it shall be done for you. Verse 8, which is the last verse, by this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit. So you will be my disciples. Something that we have learned, from the portion of the scripture, as the title of our message, it says, the master key of prayer, which is the subtitle in that if there is power in the name of Jesus Christ. Last time we spoke about the power in the blood, and this time around we speak about the power in the name. There is power in the blood, excuse me, the name, and also the words, which is the words that we read from the Bible, the spoken word or the logos word that is there, when it's taken into our spirits, and it has got a potential to deliver what that which the Father has purposed to do. Now, Jesus here is speaking. He says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. He says, every branch in me that does not bear fruit, that one, he takes it away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes. I want us to take note of this few words, prune, taking it away, that it may bear more fruit. You are already clean because of the word, which I've spoken to you. Abide in me and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit on itself, of itself, unless it abides. Here, Bible speaks about the fruit that the Heavenly Father or the vine dresser looks for in his people. And that fruit is none other than Christ-likeness. In other words, before we can do any other thing, there is a starting point in developing our relationship with our God. And in most cases, we have developed a religious, relationship where you pray as if you do not know this person, and you are not even sure if this person is going to answer you. And because of the condition of our relationship, now we have to begin somewhere. So yeah, the Bible speaks about the fruit that our Heavenly Father, or as we have spoken, the vine dresser, is looking, unto his people, for, and is looking for to his people. He is looking for each and every believer to be like Christ. Very important. I'm going to touch on that. I'm going to go there. Because he is, in order to be productive, he says a branch must submit itself to pruning. In other words, there's a branch, for instance, that does not bear fruit. And he says, no, that one, I look at it, it does not bear fruit, it's dry, and I'll take it away. Now, there is a branch that bears fruit, but this one, it must submit itself in order for it into a human being. We have to be conditioned and such that if we go through trials and testing which we dealt with during our Passover time period, we don't regard it as just God is hating us. God does pruning. It is there for more produce, for more production. In other words, if God continues to prune us, to allow us to go through some trials and testings, then we must condition our minds in such that, no, this is not, remember, I always share this principle, because if I forget to share it, there's somebody who's new, I mean, in terms of viewing our telecast, then that person will be in a position to miss what we're talking about. Any trial that comes your way, the first thing that you must do, you have to do self-examination. Examine yourself. Do introspection. Look at yourself before you can look around and accuse the enemy and accuse whoever. Is this problem not a self-caused problem? Then if there's nothing that you can find after having confessed, you have to rebuke the hand of the enemy. That's number two. Then if the trial remains, then thirdly, you have to wait on the Lord. So these things are important. Even with pruning, when a trial that is said to have come to prune you, we have to look at ourselves and do introspection. And if nothing happens, do the second one, rebuke the hand of the enemy. Thirdly, then we understand that it might be the hand of God. So pruning is not so good, but it is there for us to make sure that we become better people in terms of serving our God. And now, so a branch, like I have said, the branch must submit to pruning, that is to be disciplined and to submit to the discipline of the Father so that it must maintain the vine. Now, when he says, I am the vine, now he says, this is the seventh I am and the last self-designation in the gospel. And it's repeated in verse 5 again. And so where he says, I am the vine again. Where now, describing the relationship between Jesus Christ and his disciples, which is a very crucial relationship. Now, we're talking about the master key of prayer, the power. There is power in prayer. But how do you come to a point of having an assurance and of being sure that if I release a word in prayer, God is going to honor that word. And I'm going to be having results in terms of the prayer that I prayed to the Lord. So, now Israel in this context is compared to a vineyard under God's loving care. But unlike Israel, truly Jesus is our true vine, and we are the branches. And the fruitless branch, which does not abide, let alone bearing fruit, that does not abide in the vine, he says it is destroyed. The immediate reference was probably to Judas, as you all know, that he was there as a traitor. Then But this idea, it applies to all pseudo believers, those who pretend to be loving the Lord, those who pretend to become religious, I love the Lord, I worship Emmanuel. But it speaks about people who are not attached to the vine. So when we abide in Christ, our prayers are effective and we glorify God in our fruit bearing. You remember, every time, every moment, when a prayer is answered, in a way, we glorify God. And God is glorified by the fact that that prayer came through a believer who is attached to the vine. And every time he prays that prayer, God is honoring that prayer because he is attached to the vine. So, we demonstrate our discipleship and our joy. And our joy becomes, full through experiencing Christ's own joy within us. Let me repeat that, say that again. Our discipleship is demonstrated by the fact that we are attached to the vine. And when we are attached to the vine, we experience the joy that Christ has. And we share the same. Remember, the Lord that we follow is the same Lord who was persecuted, everything that was said to him, but he never lost joy. And when we lose joy, then we do not demonstrate our discipleship in this planet Earth. Now, abide in Jesus, the true vine. Remain in him, stay continually. Present with him. Then you will experience these three things when you abide in Christ: growth, maturity, and productivity for the kingdom of God. And we must ask ourselves in these days, why are we not productive in the kingdom of God? Because we have not been closer to our King of glory. So when we abide in him, we are sure about these things, growing in the kingdom and also maturing in the kingdom. And not only maturing in the kingdom, sharing in the good things that the Lord has with him and has in him. We become more of true brothers to Christ, where the scripture says, if we go to the book of Hebrews, chapter 2, the Bible says, we go there, I think it's 11 and 12, and I like that scripture, where it says 11 and 12, it says, for it was fitting, when we start reading from verse 10, fitting for him, for whom all things, in bringing many sons to glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through sufferings, which is, we need to all read in the scriptures. So, for both he who sanctifies, the one who made people to be sanctified before our God. And those who are being sanctified are all one, for which reason he is not ashamed to call them brethren, saying, I will declare your name to my brethren. In the midst of the assembly, I will sing praise to you. Now, and again, verse 13 says, I will put my trust in him, and again, here I am, and the children whom God has given me. Now, understand that Jesus, before anything, as we are attached in the vine, we begin to share the same mind and the same vision and the same, you know, joy that Jesus has. And that is why the scripture says, both the one who made man holy and those who are made holy, those are of the same family. And it's not ashamed. You know, remember in the previous verse, where the Bible says, for it was fitting for him who has loved Jesus, for whom are all things, and by whom are all things, you know, in other words, everything that we can think about. We're going to go to the book of Colossians, to the letter of Paul, to the Colossian church, and share some few thoughts around there, where everything that God has, he has imputed it in the life of Christ. Now, he says, whom all things and by whom all things, in bringing many sons to glory. In other words, not only himself that he went to the Father and was glorified by the Father, but Jesus paid the price so that all who believed in him may be brought into to God's glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through sufferings. That is the captain of our salvation, who is Jesus Christ. Now, perfect in some. So he suffered for what we are, for who we are, for what we are going through. And he suffered for one thing, that we are not going to be failures on the planet, on this planet Earth. We are going to make it. Victory belongs to us. Now, that's why it says both the sanctifier and those who are sanctified, they belong to the same family. And it's not ashamed, to call them my brethren. It's exactly the status where God wants to take us through, so that what is in Jesus, maybe we should go to the book of Colossians. Whatever Jesus has, we also are partakers of those benefits. So the Bible is so good in chapter 3. And in chapter 3. Let me go. Okay, the Bible says, if then you were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is sitting at the right hand of God, and set your mind on the things above, not on the things of earth. For you died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. In other words, we do not have life that is here. As we have accepted Jesus Christ, and we have allowed ourselves through pruning and other things to grow and to mature, and also to be in a position to understand the things of the kingdom, then God is there for us, and to make sure that we become productive in the kingdom of God. Now, God, it was pleasing also to him that all the fullness of the deity, in other words, every benefit of the kingdom of God in heavenly places, God was very pleased to make sure that I make it to be applicable in the life of Jesus Christ, that whoever abides with Jesus Christ, or whoever becomes a pledge to Jesus Christ, he shares, in those benefits. Now, so abiding in Jesus, which is the true vine, remaining in him, staying continually present in him, then is no choice. And making sure, let's not run away. Christians, believers in Christ, let us not run away from this thing, from the issue of pruning, we have to be pruned. Not once, not twice. Every time we grow and taking a further step, there's a test that is waiting for us there. Now, understanding the power behind the name. Now, let's go back, you know, and go back to the Old Testament. We know our God by the name Jehovah. We know our God by the name, when he introduced himself to Abraham. Because Abraham, when he was Abraham, knew nothing about this God. He said, I am El Shaddai. That's what it says there. I am El Shaddai. El Shaddai means the breastfeeding God. In other words, because that time there was a problem. He was, he do not know God, and he must introduce himself as the one who gives him, who feeds him. Now, I am the breastfeeding God. Walk before me and be blameless, and blah, 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 all those, what he said. Now, when it comes to the point where Moses was supposed to deliver the Israelites, when he introduced himself, if you read, the scriptures, and in fact, the interpretation from the original Hebrews, he introduces himself as Jehovah. Now, what does it mean? The word Jehovah, what does it mean? Jehovah is distinctly the redemptive name of the deity. And it means the self-existent one who reveals himself. Now, it's so important for you to catch up with that phrase. Jehovah, I am Jehovah. Now, in the case of Moses, I have come, I'm the self-existent one who has revealed himself to do what? To deliver my people. To save my people from the hand of Pharaoh. Now, very, very important. There is power behind the name. We spoke about the power behind the blood, or power in the blood. But this time around, there is power, which is the master key. It's in the name. If you do not understand what it means, you know, that is why when you name your children, you just don't give them names. I mean, or copy a name wherever you get it. Name has got its own implications and whatever the destiny of the child that you speak about. So, that you have thought about and you have thought about and given, I mean, to that child as a name. Because expecting something which the Lord, if you are a believer, that has communicated to your life. Now, he says, I'm Jehovah. He comes. Now, it's a redemptive, in other words, ligama elihlangulayo. And I'm the self-existent one. Ndim ndim, and who reveals himself. In other words, once you catch up with Jehovah, then you, whenever you pray, you've got the whole thing. You will know, if I touch this one, it's an emphasis, Jehovah, this one. I'm just for interest sake, because people have been praying and saying, Jehovah, Jireh, Jehovah, what? I'm Jehovah. So, no, listen, you must come to a point of understanding. First and foremost, you need to abide, you need to understand who God is and who Christ is. You must abide so that you grow, you mature, and you become productive. And you know this God. You know, because the reason why Jesus said, when you have done all these things according to this, he said, if you remain in me, you will ask anything. And people jump to the verse, you will ask anything. Now, it begins with you having abode with Christ. Now, it continues to say that the name Jehovah, I've said it here. So, for interest's sake, now, Jehovah. People have spoken about a Lord, Jehovah Shammah, Jehovah Tzidkem, and whatever. Let me explain again. Jehovah Shammah, let's just talk about that one. Yes, it means the Lord is there, or the Lord is present. Now, you can quote and talk about it and having no relationship with Christ, then it's okay for you if you decided to do it that way. But once you develop a relationship with your God, every time you open up a mouth, you know, the Bible, when it speaks about Jesus in the book of Romans, it is by him, when it speaks about the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, we cry. And we cry, we say, Abba, it means Father. Now, you cannot cry with a different spirit. You have to cry with the Spirit of, when you are connected with the Christ. And when you cry, the same Spirit that is in you, it cries to Christ. It cries to our Father. So, when you say Jehovah, you must, in the Bible, even the scribes, when they would quote the name Jehovah, they would, before they would quote the name, they would put the pens down and bow down and worship the Lord. Because it's their understanding of the word Jehovah. Once you touch, this is, I've touched the self-existent one. Who does what? Who reveals himself? Because we miss our prayers because of lack of understanding of who God is. So those people in the Old Testament, they knew the scribes, even the scribes were writing, they knew, Jehovah, you can, thou shalt not call the name of the Lord your God in vain. So when we touch this name, but I think we are there as Christians now. Let's start somewhere. Let's develop our relationship. Let's begin to make sure that as we say it, we say it, that I am, you must be holy because I, the Lord, your God, am holy. That is Leviticus. It's a standard and it does not change. You call this. It says Shama. Let's look at that. Shama is the Hebrew word which is there. Or present, revealing, to us, revealing to us the redemptive privilege of enjoying the presence of the Lord. And the Bible says in the book of Matthew chapter 28, it speaks very clear when it commands, the last command, go and make disciples of all nations. And the Bible says, lo, at the end of the verse, I am with you always. And now, we don't have to jump to the scripture. To that verse. Check yourself when you begin to start using the name of the Lord. Now, because behind the name, there is power. There is deliverance. God answers our prayer. And when we know it, Father God, I am here before you. I confess all that I think it might not place me in a good standing with you. Then you come and present yourself in the right way. Now, we said that this blessing is provided. In actual, it takes us to the blood by the atonement. That has been done through the blood of Jesus Christ. And can you see that these are triplets? The blood and the name of and also the word. So, in other words, Shama, you are trying to say now you are in a crisis or there's something that threatens you and that says, I don't think God, is around at this time, and you say Jehovah. In fact, what God? Saying, we are saying, the self-existent one, reveal yourself and let me feel your presence. In other words, if you can paraphrase that verse, Jehovah Shammah, it means self-existent one, reveal yourself. I know that you do not hide yourself. Reveal yourself in this problem. And you pick again. We say, Jehovah Shalom. You feel that I have no peace at all. And I'm restless. I don't know what to do. You know, everything is just working upside down. I'm confused. Then Shalom comes in. The Lord, our peace. You know, now, in other words, Jehovah, the self-existent one who reveals himself. You are saying again, reveal yourself because, I mean, with peace, with Shalom, with peace in this situation. In other words, I don't know, I'm in a cul-de-sac. I don't know, or I'm in a crossroads. I don't know which way to take, but you call upon him, he's going to answer that prayer. Immediately say, I am the self-existent one with knowledge, with understanding that he reveals himself at all times. And again, with some, they say, Jehovah Ra'ah or Rapha, I mean, Rohi. Some would say Ra'ah or Rohi. It means also the self-existent. You know, I always want to, because to go back to this. Because when you know, it's important. When you do not know, God does not bless ignorance. He is not blessed at all. Because he has given us all the tools. He has given us pastors. He has given us the fivefold ministry to teach us. He has given you the Bible to read it. And he has given you the Holy Spirit to make sure that he interprets the word of God for you. Now, Rohi, it means to say, the Lord is my shepherd. You know, you can go to Psalm 23, you can go to John 10, I mean 10. I'm a good shepherd. You know, he is our shepherd. Now, when you feel that there is absolutely no protection, you feel that you are naked to the hands of the enemy. The enemy is there to attack you. The enemy is there. You think that there is the self-existent one who reveals himself, who does not keep quiet, reveals himself as Ra'ah or Rohi, as a shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, it means the Lord will always be with you. He will never leave you. He will never forsake you because he will be your God, your rear guard, and your goes before you again. So, Rohi is the shepherd. You see, when we pray, you can feel that all these things that we spend maybe an hour, 2 hours, they are just encompassed in few words if you only have a revelation of what it means. So, in other words, it will go further again where it says the Jehovah Nissi means the Lord is my victor, is my captain. The scripture that I read in the book of Hebrews, that it was fitting for him to perfect him as a captain, you know, of our suffering. He was there for us. He's a captain. Anything that you are going through, he is there as a banner, captain, that is going to ensure that every trial that you are going through, every battle that you are fighting now, you are going to make sure you are going to win it. Because he's your banner. Banner means I'm lifting up this for victory. That is my captain. He goes before you, your captain. I mean, the captains do not sit behind. They go in front of the army. Jesus is my army. The self-existent, one who reveals himself in battles. When I'm fighting battles, I'm not fighting those battles alone. Now, goes again and talk about the one that people love most, and then it says, Jehovah Jireh. means the Lord will provide. You know, any lack, anything, you go to God first and say, Father God, I'm standing before you in adoration and thanksgiving. My God, you prepare a table in front of the enemy. And the enemy is anything that threatens us. Now, you know, it would be food, would be anything that we lack now, that he prepares the table before, I mean, our enemies. And there's no great enemy than poverty, than drought. And that is a challenge in the lives of human beings. That is why even the politicians, they use, I mean, the poverty to make sure that they hijack whatever. I'm not saying it's not always the case. But those, when they campaign, they would campaign around those things. But the Lord is our provider. As a believer, stand before your God and make sure that you know your God, that your God is the provider. Now, is the self-existent one who reveals himself where there is lack, where there is nothing. You can even today and stand before the Lord your God. Then Jehovah Tsidkenu. Tsidkenu, it means the Lord, our righteousness. We cannot leave, I mean, righteousness behind. Righteousness, that is the thing that makes sure that the light always, I mean, goes before us. And when we need righteousness, when we can see that in our lives, they were struggling with sin, were struggling with anything that is challenging your inner core, you can stand up and say, Jehovah, the self-existent one who reveals himself, when I go through this, I mean, conflict in my spirit of being tainted by sin, sinful thoughts and everything, you can call him, is the God, our righteousness. And Jehovah Rapha means, I am your physician. That one I like. I think next Sunday I'll be talking mostly in that one. The Lord, our physician. I'm going to dwell on that one in prayer. Now, if we can go back to the scripture, to John. You know, John, I'm going to explain that because I don't want to leave, I mean, that scripture that is, I mean, that is our key scripture for the day in John 15, where the Bible speaks about, I mean, the vine. Now, the Bible says there in verse 7, if you abide in me and my ways, because I'll be talking about ways, maybe in the third Sunday, and my ways abide in you, you will ask what you desire, and it shall be done for you. And we must even think about this. When verse 8 says, by this, it means when we get our answers, when our prayers are answered, when having abode with the Lord, and the words, his words are always abiding with us. Now he says, God is glorified that we bear much fruit, and then we become his disciples. In other words, every time God, I mean, does something, I mean, anything that happens in our life, and when we pray, anything that we've been thinking of, because having aligned our thoughts with God, we are matured enough to align our thoughts, we become productive. We ask anything, because that which we ask is going to line up with the production. That on this planet Earth, God is glorified, because every tool that we need in terms of making sure that in this kingdom we become effective, God is going to supply. And we benefit in each and every tool. In other words, what the Bible is saying, you won't be just asking anything, going around and asking everything to play around. You know, everything that you are going to ask, will make sure that it is done out of you being matured and out of you having grown enough in understanding the things of the kingdom. Now, what this Bible now is saying is that ask anything that you desire. Oh my God, catch up with the will of God first. Know who your God is and understand how your God does things. And then you ask anything, tools will come. You also benefit from those tools of the kingdom. Now, there is power that it specifies something and it says, let me go back to, if you abide in me and my ways abide in me, you will ask what you desire and it shall be done for you. By this, my Father is glorified. And this is so important. Now, when we look at the scriptures, other scriptures, where the name of Jesus is so important, and it's so important. Now, you think that how did these people, how were they praying to God? In Luke 24, verse 47, Bible speaks about the repentance and forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name. In other words, Jesus, as the book of Colossians says, that God was pleased. Now, if we know our God as the self-existent one who reveals himself, God now, the self-existent one, was pleased to do what? To make sure that he inputs everything, he gives him, Jesus, everything that he has. So, in other words, when you go to Jesus in his name, it means he, the self-existent one who reveals is found in the name of Jesus Christ. In other words, if we repent, forgiveness of sins, it's as sure as your sins will be forgiven. And John 14, verse 13. The Bible says in John 14, verse 13, let's start from verse 12. It says, most assuredly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do. The works that I do, he will do. And then also, and greater works than these, he will do. Because I go to my Father, and whatever you ask in my name, and whatever you ask in my name, that's something in the name. I don't want to mention things. You must mark when you name your children, and you don't just give children names. Out of your frustrations. So, and because what? I will do. Because I go to my Father, and whatever you ask in my name, that I will do. That the Father again. That's something in this God. This God may be glorified in the Son. If you ask, this is for the seventh time within these two verses. If you ask anything in my name, I will do that. And I always be mindful, because that's why I've started teaching about abiding in Christ. It's so important for you to understand. But when I ask in what manner? So, it is being said for the second time here. You ask in the name of Jesus. In that name, there is the self-existent one who reveals himself. And make sure that you are in the right position. Now, in John 15, verse 16, and the Bible says in verse 16, you did not choose me. I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit and that your fruit should remain. But that whatever you ask the Father, you say, Father God, in my name, he may give you these things I command you, that you love one another. So, there is something that is in the name of Christ. There's something That is in the name, when you've developed a relationship with the person of the name. Now, Pastor Lord, our breakthroughs are here. Understand, know your relationship with Christ. Know who you are in Christ. And understand how you do things. You do things according to your relationship that has developed with Christ. John 20, verse 31. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, is the Son of God, and that by believing you in his name, you may have life in his name. Oh my God, that we look for life and we cannot find life except if by believing in his name, then we can have life. We enjoy life, we share joys that Christ enjoyed. Everything that we think about, it is going to be done. In Acts chapter 3, verse 16, Paul says, by faith in the name of Jesus, this man that was John and Peter, they say Peter and John, they say, by faith in the name of Jesus, this man whom you see, it was a lame man that was healed. And no, you don't see it, only you know this man, he was sitting around you, he was a lame man. I mean, and no, was made strong. It is Jesus' name and the faith that comes through him, and the faith, I'm sorry, that comes through this man, I mean, that has given his complete healing to him, as you call, I mean, as we can all see with your eyes. The faith of this man in the name of Jesus Christ. What you see has got nothing about us, but it is in the self-existent one who reveals himself. When we call the name, when we say in the name of Jesus, we must know that the fullness of the deity is in Jesus Christ. And God, it was pleasing for him to make sure that healing is in him, peace is in him, deliverance is in him. You know what I mean? Shepherding is in him. Everything that we need is in him in the name of Jesus Christ. And Peter, he said to the man, silver and gold I don't have, but I'm going to give you what I have. I have the name. What do you have with you? Have you accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior? Do you have this name? Instead of being told by other people, running after the prophets, running after people, the name, it is above of every name. This name, when you receive Christ as your personal Savior, you carry the name. Yeah, the Spirit of God comes into your life and dwells with you. And with Christ is in you, God the Father is in you. He says, the Holy Spirit, when he comes, my Father and I will come and make our abode through the Holy Spirit in your life. When you receive Christ, you carry the name, you can call upon the self-existent one who reveals himself in every problem. You are sick, call the self-existent one who reveals himself. You have a lack, call the self-existent one who reveals himself. But by saying, I'm providing, you have no peace, call the self-existent one who reveals himself and gives you, says, my peace I give unto you. As we are closing today, receive Christ as your personal Savior. Father God, I pray for each and every person, every household, my God. I release, my God, the Spirit of Christ, Lord, within our families, to for the understanding of the self-existent one who reveals himself when we are in trouble. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.